In this next tutorial, you'll learn to use PCA for dimensionality reduction and to reconstruct your data from the lower dimensional representation. Again, the goal of dimensionality reduction is to reduce your data from a large number of variables that you're observing directly to a smaller number of features that can capture much of the structure in your data. And we can do this with PCA just by taking the first K principal components. That's because we've already been able to rank the components in terms of how much of the variance of the data they're able to explain. And so we can just take the first K columns of the score matrix, and I'll call that S sub 1 through K. And that gives us the lower dimensional representation of the data that explains as much variance as possible. But the real question now is, how do you choose K? And to illustrate this, I'll use an example from the previous tutorial. It's important to distinguish here between the intrinsic and the extrinsic dimensionality. The extrinsic dimensionality is the number of variables that we're observing. So in this case, it's just 2. The intrinsic dimensionality is the number of degrees of freedom in our data. And you can see on the left that in this case, since the activity of neuron 1 and 2 are so perfectly correlated, there's actually only 1 degree of freedom because you only need 1 coordinate in order to describe all of the data, and that's the projection onto the first basis vector. You can also see this in the scree plot on the right. So the eigenvalue of the second component is exactly 0, and that means that there is no variation in the data along the second basis vector. On the other hand, in this example, you do actually need both of the coordinates from both basis vectors in order to describe the data. So in this case, the intrinsic dimensionality is also 2 in addition to the extrinsic dimensionality. And in the scree plot, you can see this because the two components have the same eigenvalue, suggesting that they have the same amount of variation in both of these directions. But typically we see something that's in between. So here we have most of the variance is in the first direction, but there's a little bit of variation in the second basis vector as well. And in the scree plot, you can see that because the second component is not 0, but it's much smaller than the first component. This is a much more difficult case to determine because we may not be sure if that second component is reflecting some interesting feature or if it's just reflecting measurement noise in the data. So here, without any additional information, the intrinsic dimensionality could be 1, it could be 2, it could be something in between, but it's not so clear cut. In general, to determine the intrinsic dimensionality, we can look at the scree plot and find when the eigenvalues go to 0. And so in this case, the extrinsic dimensionality is 50 and the intrinsic dimensionality is 20. And that's because the 20 through 50th components have no variation in the data. But this is a very idealized example, and usually in neural data, because of noise, we don't ever see any 0 eigenvalues. So it's usually much more of a graded decrease, like in this example. And so there are a couple different ways to get around this. One is to look for an elbow or a kink in the scree plot, which could suggest that some of the eigenvalues are due to signal, and separate those from the ones that are probably due to noise, which would be lower. This doesn't always work because you don't always see a kink. So another way to get around this is to look at the total variance explained. This is exactly the same information as in the previous plot, but I'm just showing it in a different way. So now the point for the 10th component is the fraction of the variance explained by the first 10 components. So I'm summing the eigenvalues for the first through 10th principal components, and I'm normalizing that by the sum of the eigenvalues for all of the components. And the way to determine the intrinsic dimensionality using this method is to essentially look for some threshold, let's say 90% of the variance, and see how many components are necessary to explain that amount of the variance in the data. So in this case, that again gives 20 components. And this is a very common way to assess the intrinsic dimensionality in neuroscience. In this next exercise, you will use PCA to determine the intrinsic dimensionality of the MNIST dataset. MNIST is a very common dataset that is very widely used for benchmarking data algorithms, and it's made of 70,000 samples of different handwritten digits. each sample is a 28 by 28 pixel image of a different digit. And to take a neuroscience analogy, you could imagine that each pixel is the firing rate of a different retinal ganglion cell, and this is a little patch of the retina. To build the data matrix, we can just unravel the 28 by 28 pixel image into a very long 784 pixel length row vector, and then we stack the vectors for different samples as usual. So now it's your turn to apply PCA to MNIST and try to infer the intrinsic dimensionality.